11 apostles and selected other people that were important, and how they inspired them, and where they inspired them. We'll look at it a little bit later. You'll also get a chance to look at it in small groups. So hang on to it. If you've got one, hang on to it. Take it with you. It will be very interesting for you to look at where some of these people inspired. Because we'll look at a map at the end tonight. When I'm done speaking, we're going to look at a map of how far the apostles got before they were murdered for the gospel. Because there's only one apostle that was not murdered. And he was exiled to an island to die alone. And that was John. But all the rest of them were murdered. So everybody open your Bibles to Acts chapter 1. He said to them, "It is not for you to know times or seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth." You know, guys, you know, people really put a premium on people's last words, don't they? That's the thing, is when you hear somebody, you know, that's a big deal, is last words. Because people always like to resolve things in their last words. You know, they get to deal with family conflict in their last words. They get to share important things they've learned in their life in their last words. It's always important to hear someone's last words. Now, you notice I didn't say dying last words, because these weren't Jesus' dying last words. These were Jesus' last words to his disciples before he went back to heaven. And what does he say to them? He says, listen, he says, you are not going to know when I'm going to come back. There's no way you can know. You're not going to know the times or the seasons of anything. However, I am going to send you another one. I am going to send you the Holy Spirit. And not only that, you know, not if that wasn't enough good news, I'm also going to send you out into the world to share the gospel. Now, do these men go to all these places? You'll get to see the map. Guys, believe it or not, they went to all these places and even further. The disciples visited from Spain all the way to India and everywhere in between. They visited the whole northern half of Africa. They visited all of what we consider the Middle East. They visited up into Russia, Bulgaria, Romania, Italy. They visited modern-day Iraq, modern-day Iran, and modern-day Afghanistan, Pakistan, and India. They went all the way across. They went as far south as Ethiopia, and as far north as Russia. So guys, when you see a map of the ancient world, which stretches from Spain over to about where Iraq is today, they went off the map the other direction. They covered all that area. They all died in doing that. And what we're going to look at tonight is we're going to look at how they got to that point, how they prepared for that, how they were ready to do that for Jesus. So, that's on here. All right. Jesus just died. You know, they're now down to 11 men. Because what happens? What happened to the other one?
He killed himself.
He did kill himself. How did he kill himself?
He hung himself.
They also say it wasn't just that. He hung himself and it broke. And it, yeah. That it broke and he fell on the rocks and it, his body. Yeah, it's wonderful, isn't it? But you know, that's, listen, I know it sounds horrible, but that's what happened. All right. Jesus says, listen. And You know, the cool thing is tonight I can actually work two Star Wars clips into. I know it's cheesy, but there are two perfect Star Wars clips that I can weave in. So one of them is Yoda, and it's only 9 seconds long, but it's hold on. But Jennifer will play it. It's one of my favorite lines in the movie ever.
You want me to play it?
Play it.
Do or do not.
There is another.
Alright, so what does Yoda say?
There is another.
There is another. And I know some of y'all are like, that was a really short clip. But what they're talking about before that is they're telling Luke, listen, we don't want you to leave. You know, you're being rash. You know, we really don't want you to leave. It's not time for you to leave yet. And Luke says, no, I need to go. It's time. And Yoda and Ghost Obi-Wan are talking. And Ghost Obi-Wan is like, man, what are we gonna do? That's our last hope. And what's Yoda say? No, there is another. Guys, this is exactly how the apostles felt as Jesus went up to heaven. You know, Jesus says, listen, don't lose hope, because I'm going to send another one. I'm gonna send you the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit is going to give you power. And I can guarantee these men are just standing there going, what in the world are you talking about? You know, you're leaving. Now, they had great joy because he came back from the dead, but now he's leaving again. And they're like, man, what in the world? So, if you fast forward to Acts 2, we're not going to read it. You'll read it in small groups tonight. But, you know, Jesus says, listen, you need to go to Jerusalem. You need to, he sends two angels to tell them, listen, go to Jerusalem. Stay there until the Holy Spirit shows up. And boy, does the Holy Spirit show up. I mean, this is, what? You know, just crazy. I know that sounds weird, but I mean, it really is. I can't imagine being in that room. No, I'm not doing that again. I can't imagine being in that room when the Holy Spirit shows up. Tongues of fire and rushing wind. And guys, it was such a spectacle that the crowd showed up. You know, people started gathering around going, what's going on? But the cool thing, the thing we're going to focus on tonight is what happens afterwards. And Peter stands up and starts preaching. This is the man who had run away after Jesus was arrested, had denied Jesus three times. You know, this man was a coward. But yet he stands up in front of thousands of people and starts plainly and concisely explaining the gospel to these people in their own languages. So that everybody could understand, no matter where they were from. Guys, if that's not power, I don't know what it is. You know, I mean, if you have to describe the Holy Spirit, how would you describe it? Well, my number one word would be, huh? I know, that's the thing. I mean, it's, you know, it's just like the way it showed up. You know, Gabby made fun of the way, you know, but, you know, it's this thing. I mean, it's part of the Trinity, and it's, I mean, you can tell people what it does, but you know, it really is indescribable. You know, it is, you know, I can guarantee you, if you were in that room and you described it as rushing wind and tongues of fire, that pales in comparison to what actually happened in that room when the Holy Spirit showed up. I think that this is one of those moments that we as humans can't completely explain in mere words what was going on. Because, you know, guys, you've got this guy that had denied Jesus three times. And then he stands up and starts preaching in all these languages. Everybody can understand. In front of thousands of people. You know, guys, it's a lot like us. You know, before Jesus, you know, we want to do everything in our flesh, in our own power. And after you accept Jesus into your life and you begin growing and you allow the Holy Spirit to work, what's supposed to happen is you're supposed to allow the Holy Spirit to do that work, to guide you. And what you do is you become a vessel. You go and do God's work and you allow God to work through you and that power to well up, to overwhelm you. And that's what Peter did. Peter said, fine, God, you want me to stand up and speak? Let's go. But who was doing the speaking? It wasn't Peter. That was the Holy Spirit speaking through him, man. Could Peter have said, no, I don't really think I want to do that. I'm just going to sit here for a while. You know, old Peter would have. I'm not really sure if I want to do that. I mean, it's the same thing Moses, in the same excuse Moses gave. What excuse did Moses give? He said, yeah, I can't speak. And we actually believe that, that Moses had probably had a stuttering problem and really wasn't a good public speaker. You know, Moses tried to get out of it, but what did God do? In Moses' frailties, in Moses' you know, the amount of messed up stuff in Moses' life, God came through, and through God's power was huge. Did great things because Moses allowed God to work. You know, Moses still had problems. All right, second favorite clue. It's Yoda again. You can't beat Yoda. He says the force of something beyond just this crude matter, beyond just your flesh. You know, guys, why do you think it's called the Holy Spirit? You know, and I know the force is, I mean, the Holy Spirit is not the trees and the rocks and the ground and the ship. I know that. But it's, you know, it's amazing sometimes how things in movies like this can be exactly what God's talking about. You know, what Yoda is telling Luke is you cannot do this. You alone cannot do this. You have to allow the force to freely flow through you to do this. You know, it's the same thing God, you know, it's the same thing that Jesus tells the disciples. He said, you know, verse 8, he says, but you will receive power when the who shows up? The Holy Spirit shows up. You know, it's the same thing. You know, Jesus is like, listen, you don't have power right now. But when the Holy Spirit shows up and you allow the Holy Spirit to work through you, you will have power. And it will be incredible. It will be beyond anything you can imagine. Guys, can you imagine standing up in front of 3,000 people and preaching in their language? I can't imagine that. And we don't know how big the crowd was. We just know that there were thousands of people that accepted Jesus that day. You know, we know that there were 3,000 people saved, but we don't know how big the crowd really was. You know, guys, I don't know about you, but that, I mean, that excites me. Is if I allow the Holy Spirit to work through me, I can do stuff like that. Wow. The coolest part for me is where the disciples went later. How far they got, where they went, what they did. And, you know, Jesus says, listen, he said, here are your marching orders. Once the Holy Spirit shows up, you're going to have power. And here's what I want you to do with that power. In verse 8, at the end of it, he says, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria. I know the word is misspelled. And the end of the earth. I know it is what. So, oh, I was typing fast. You know, guys, that's what Jesus says. He says, listen, you believe in me now, I'm going to send you the Holy Spirit. But I don't want you just to stay in Jerusalem. I want you to go to Jerusalem. I want you to go to Judea. Which, here's the thing, Jerusalem is in where? It was in Israel, but it's in Judea. I mean, that's the province that Jerusalem is in. And then, we want you to go to Samaria. What's the big deal with Samaria? Yes! The Jews and the Samaritans did not like one another. So, I want you to go and tell people that you don't like about who I am. Because I love those people, even if you don't. And then I want you to go to the ends of the earth. Anywhere that there are people that need to hear the gospel, I want you to go there. Which is where? Everywhere. And did they go everywhere? Guys, they went as far as they could go in that time period. They might have been able to get to China, but evidently God didn't want them to go there. So, all right, so if you look at the map, here's the cool thing about the map. Everywhere that there's a cross is where an apostle or a significant other, meaning somebody like Stephen or Matthias, died. Everywhere that there's just a name with no cross, that's where they visited and preached the gospel. So if you notice, now India's down in the right-hand corner. Obviously, that's not where India really is. But you notice Thomas and Bartholomew both went to India and died there. Pretty horrible deaths. Guys, some of these guys were flayed open. Their skin was flayed and they were killed. Listen, and some of y'all are like, this is horrible, Brian. Why are you talking about this? There were some of these disciples, some were attempted to be, you know, they tried to boil them in oil, and they actually got out, and then they died. They were crucified upside down. They were, I'm trying to remember, I think it was Thomas, was spitted on a spear, like, through his body, and that's how he died. There were others that were ripped apart. Some were beheaded. Some were crucified. Guys, and this sounds horrible. You're like, why are you talking about this?
What's a halberd?
A halberd is a long, it's shaped like a spear, but it's got a big axe head on top.
Is that like a shish kebab? Okay, yeah, you really
want to talk about it. Yeah. Guys, you may ask, why are you talking about this? Guys, here's the thing. If you truly believe in something, are you willing to die for it? I mean, I'm being serious. You know, there's only three ways you can really look at the disciples, the apostles. There's only three options you have in believing who they were. Number one is that they were men that died for a lie and knew it. And they did it anyway. Well, we're gonna talk about it in just a minute. Number two, they were all delusional and crazy. So they died for a lie and didn't really realize that it was a lie. Number three, what they said was true. Christ did rise from the grave, and it was who he and he was who he said he was. You know, guys, number one, they died for a lie and knew it. That makes no sense. Because if you know something's not true, are you willing to die for it? Have you ever thought about that before? Are you willing to die for something you don't believe in? Most people aren't. You know, why do you think parents are willing to die for children or for their spouse? It's because they truly love those people. You know, I don't think sometimes, you know, people say, well, you know, those men were just, they knew that what they believed was a lie, that Jesus' body had just been taken by the soldiers or been taken and they buried him somewhere else. Guys, they wouldn't have gone to Spain and India and everywhere in between and been flayed open and hung up, you know, crucified upside down and boiled in oil and stabbed with spears and poison darts and, you know, none of that would have happened because you don't die for a lie. All right, so they're all delusional and crazy. What's wrong with that one?
They weren't the losing moment.
What? What?
I mean, nothing gets to have
people that were here that were
doctors. They weren't the losing moment.
If you're delusional and crazy, do you preach a sermon where 3,000 people believe and there's many different languages in that crowd?
You're not delusional.
And they all hear in their language. What? What'd you say?
Those people are also.
Yeah. No, well, that's the thing. So that's a mass delusion. You're looking, and there's over 3,000 people all having the same delusion. Guys, it's hard, it's easy to point and say that person's crazy when you have very little evidence. But when there's mountains of evidence, it's really hard to point and say that person's crazy when they have all this evidence to back them up. You know, do you, even if you're crazy and delusional, do you still, you know, are you willing to die for that? And you'll talk a little bit about that tonight. And number three, what they said was true. You know, guys, if you truly believe in something, are you willing to die for it? You know, it's a question we ask. The reason that Christians should be willing to die for the gospel is because we know that there is somewhere greater than anywhere we can imagine here on earth that we get to go to. If we do expire, when we do die, I think so often we forget that. Is, you know, when we die, we get to go to a better place. And every one of these men knew it, guys. They just like, man, I get to go see Jesus again. Woohoo! And they did. Even, you know, and you'll read the story of Stephen tonight. And what, and it is awesome. And you know how much Stephen really cared about the gospel when you read about at the very end of his life. What's the last thing he says? Because we are talking about last words. He says, I see the Son of Man. And Son of Man, I want you to forgive these people because they don't know what they're doing. Which is funny because what did Jesus do on the cross right before he died? Father, forgive them because they don't know what they're doing. You know, guys, last words are important. This man believed so much in the message that he was delivering to people that he forgave the men that were killing him. I don't think you can get a better testimony of how powerful the gospel is than that. All right, everybody back here, that's what we're doing. God, thank you for tonight. Thank you for the opportunity to come before you, to worship, to talk about being able to go out and share the gospel. These men that you sent with that message, this first 11 that you sent out. Lord, thank you for those men. Thank you for the opportunity to read about them, to know who they were. Lord, and I pray that by their example that we would do a better job of sharing your gospel with others. In your name, I pray. Amen. All right, guys. Let's go to small groups.